Hi, I'm Craig Price with Surface Water Solutions. Welcome to our first ever YouTube video upload. I'm going on about 50 years old here, and I've never yet uploaded anything to YouTube, so it's about time for me to catch up. I do apologize in advance for any technical glitches. I'm just going to let this keep running even if I mess up, but I do appreciate any feedback that can help us improve these videos going forward. Now, what this is all about is HECRAS 5.0.4, which has just been released. Comes with some exciting new features, exciting in a nerdy kind of way, but one of the features that we wanted to focus on in this particular video is the ability to create a 1D geometry directly in RAS Mapper without relying on GeoRAS or any other third-party software. So let's get right to it. I want to keep this under 10 minutes, so I'm going to crank through this. We're going to create a model from scratch. I've already got folders set up with the terrain file and a projection file, but if you hit File, New, I'm going to enter in file name and a title here, and when I hit OK, it says I'm in SI units. If you need to change that, do so under Options. I'm going to go right into RAS Mapper here, and the first thing you always do in RAS Mapper is to set the projection. Now, I like to keep my projection files in a separate folder for projection files to avoid mixing them up with HECRAS project files. With that set, I can now add my terrain. I'm going to add an existing one that I've already created before as an HDF file. Here it is. And you can see the terrain now, but let's make sure it's in the right place. I'm going to right-click on Map Layers, Add Web Imagery. Select Google Satellites. You can try whatever you like in here. This one, though, in order to be able to see whether we're in the right projection, I'm going to change the transparency so that we can see right through it. And it looks like the rivers line up, so we're good to go. As I zoom in here, one of the new features you'll notice in HECRAS 5.0.4 is the ability to use your middle mouse wheel to pan and zoom just like you would in any other CAD or GIS program. Now, what we really want to get to here is the ability to edit geometries and create geometries right in RAS Mapper. And you can see here, instead of going to this button right here like you normally would, we're going to go into Geometries under RAS Mapper, right click, and add a new geometry. That's going to give me this window here asking for a file name. I'm going to call this one Gold Creek. And with that, I now have a geometry that I could open up in the main window, but first I'm going to add a few things to it. The river is the first thing I'm going to draw here. In order to do so like you would in the geometry viewer, this is a little bit different. It's like a GIS layer where you have to edit the geometry first. So I'm going to now delineate this center line, going right down the middle of the river, drawn in an upstream to downstream direction. The orientation in HECRAS is always as if you were in a boat. The chainage or the stationing starts from the downstream end, but you're going to delineate it from the upstream end. I'm going to call this one Gold Creek because it's only a short reach. The reach name and river name are going to be identical. Now I've got my center line defined. I'm going to stop editing this, save my edits, and go right into my bank lines now. In the bank lines, when I start editing those, I'm essentially tracing the overbanks here. I could turn on contours to get better definition for this. Essentially, what I'm trying to do is distinguish between the overbank roughness areas and the channel roughness areas in a 1D model. As I define these again, I'm going to click on each node and then double-click in the end. And now I've got my banks defined, right and left. Stop editing those. Next is to define my flow paths. This represents the center of the conveyance area in your floodplain on the left overbank. And on the right overbank, we've got the same thing. This also allows HECRAS to compute the downstream reach lengths differently for the left and right overbanks than from the channel. With those lines drawn, the last thing I need to do is add cross sections. I'm going to edit those cross sections. Make sure when you delineate these other lines, the five lines that exist there, that none of them cross. But when you draw cross sections, left to right looking downstream, make sure that those cross sections cross all five of these lines once and only once. Now, I'm not doing a great job of delineating these. I could break these sections and make them a little better oriented to be able to show you that they're perpendicular to the flow paths, and that they represent water surface elevation contours with flat surfaces. With these ones drawn, I'm essentially done now. When I stop editing this, I actually now have a 1D geometry that I could go in and edit. I'm going to now exit out of this, out of RasMapper, and open up my geometry from the geometry data editor. When I pull this in now, I've got the one that I already named here, Gold Creek. It's GO1. You can see the cross sections that I've drawn here. What I'm going to do now is add my roughness areas to it. I'm going to do that in a table. Now I could define that as a shape file and get horizontally varying roughness. I'm just going to paste in some values in here for the overbanks and the center line. Now, with this in place, I can now save my geometry, put in some unsteady flow. You can see right here my boundary conditions have already been assigned. I'll go ahead and put a flow hydrograph in the upper reach. Now, I'll just assign this one to have a minimum flow here, maybe go up to, well, say, 1,000, and then back down to 10. I'll interpolate the missing values. Let's go ahead and plot the data just so that we can see that we don't have any typos in there, and say OK. I'll save this. We'll call that a 100-year flow arbitrarily. Now for the downstream slope, I'm going to give it a normal depth. Let's call this 0.001, and I could measure this using holding control down on my geometry viewer and then hold control down again on the cross section that you plot, and that'll actually give you the actual slope. In this case, we don't have bathymetry reflected yet, and we're going to use this 1D geometry to edit our terrain data. So with that, I've saved my unsteady flow data. Next thing I need to do is run the plan. I'm going to turn on 1, 2, and 4 here. And what I like to do for my times is put them in the future unless it's a real event, so that I know that it's a hypothetical event. I'm just going to run this one for 1 hour, and we'll just assign some times that make sense for this one. Maybe on the computational interval, 5 seconds should be plenty, given our cross-sectional spacing here. And I'll make the rest of them 1 minute, just so that we have a few frames to look at. Now with these in place, I'm going to go ahead and save my plan. It's going to ask me for a title and also for a short ID. Remember, the short ID is very important because it becomes your legend and your folder name going forward. So I'm going to save this plan now, and let's compute this and run. Run. Let's see if we can get some flows in here, and if so, we've got a working 1D reach that we can then go in and hook up with any 2D reaches. We can link it up with lateral weirs. We can put a 2D reach on the upstream or downstream end of this, and essentially we're able to just use this in a couple of different ways now. Number one, I can animate this as a profile. Watch my flow come and go. Here's my flood wave coming up and coming back down, and this is in the 1D editor. I can also go in now in RasMapper and have a look and animate it here. And when I animate it in RasMapper, I could also put some profile lines in here and watch the same thing happen. Turn on my depths here. I don't like that they default to 15 meters. That's quite deep. But with it a little shallower, I can actually turn on my particle tracing once I've gone and animated it this way. And let's have some look at the particle tracing here. Now I can move around the particle tracing speed. I can adjust the density. I can play around with this a bit, and it's kind of fun to see. But again, keep in mind, this is 1D, meaning that the hydraulic calculations ignored every bit of the terrain between these cross sections in doing their computations. So this might look like 2D output, but it is really just based on these cross sections. So with that, I hope you enjoyed that. I hope you have fun with these new features in HecRaz. Next, we're going to take this and use it to manipulate the terrain and do some other fun things with it. So again, hope you enjoyed it. Give me some feedback and let me know what you'd like to see in these tutorials. Thank you.